10 more number of students attending the class. So in a way, it is not bad, you know, to at least make sure that students attend classes, even if it is uninteresting. Sometimes they attend and figure out how uninteresting it can be. On a very light note, I mean, I'll start with the class in 1 or 2 minutes. So I heard this from our late Professor S.K. Som, who was one of the very respected professors in fluid mechanics. So he told me that one of his teachers, when he was a student, told that next Monday I will take a surprise class test. So of course all the students laughed at this, because Monday and surprise, you know, both are together. Now for me, it's an inverse or a reverse problem. I say Monday I will take a class test, but it has been a surprise that I am not taking a class. But anyway, let us move forward. I will upload the writing pad and then we will move forward.
Sir, also we are experiencing a cyclone here, so it was helpful for us too.
Yeah, I mean, cyclone, you know, I can realize that, you know, it is not that bad at Kharagpur at this moment, but at different places it is, it must be, at some places it should be severe as per the weather prediction. So I hope that all of you are at least safe at your homes and do not go out, just, you know, hang around. Hopefully tomorrow the weather will be better. So let us upload it. So can you all see the writing pad?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So we will continue. If you recall that we were discussing about the application of linear momentum conservation principle through the Reynolds transport theorem, which is the integral form of the conservation law that we have been applying, first for mass conservation and then for momentum conservation. Now, one of the key things that we considered, let me just write here, that the control volume is stationary. So this is one of the key points that we have considered. For our analysis. Now, it is not always convenient to choose a control volume which is stationary. For example, say we are interested to analyze the motion of a rocket. And to analyze the motion of a rocket, we cannot consider a, you know, rocket as a stationary control volume. Not only it is moving, but it is also accelerating. And therefore, for several problems of practical interest, starting from our day-to-day engineering to whatever, space sciences and so on, we need to go beyond the stationary control volume and consider that instead of this, we can have an arbitrarily moving control volume. So what do you mean by arbitrarily moving control volume? Means that, you know, it is absolutely arbitrary. That means it could have any type of translation, uniform motion or acceleration, and any type of rotation, which could be constant angular velocity or even angular acceleration. So that is what we mean by arbitrarily moving control volume. So to cast the equation to arbitrarily moving control volume, we must understand that the Newton's second law is applicable via inertial reference. So what is the inertial reference frame? A inertial reference frame is a non-accelerating reference frame. So non-accelerating means what? Non-accelerating means either it is having a uniform translational motion, that means it is non-accelerating, or it is not having any angular motion. Because if it is having any angular motion, it will not be an inertial frame because of the forces on the frame that will invariably make you feel radially outwards, a force radially outwards, that is the so-called centrifugal force. So what it means mathematically is that we need to again have a change of basis from inertial reference frame to a non-inertial. Why? Because our well-known laws and equations are described via inertial reference. So if we develop a mathematical mapping of inertial to non-inertial, then we can have a reverse mapping from non-inertial to inertial, and we can apply the basic law, mathematical law, for the inertial. That is what is our objective. So to fulfill that objective, there are certain foundations that we must have. So one such foundation is to find out derivative of first, this is the first mathematical foundation, fixed, quote unquote fixed, fixed vector in a moving reference. So why I have written this quote unquote fixed within quote is because it is not fixed in an absolute sense. This vector is fixed if you consider the moving reference plane. That means if you are sitting on the moving reference plane, it will appear to be a fixed vector to you. But if you are outside, it will appear to be moving. For example, if you connect two points on a rotating disk, say there is a rotating disk and there are two points, one and two, say you connect by a position vector. So if you are sitting on the disk and the disk is rotating, that means you do not see any change in this, and you are also sitting on the disk. But from outside there is a change because of the rotation, it is changing its orientation with respect to time. So in that way, although it is fixed with respect to this, you know, rotating disk, but from outside inertial reference plane, this appears to be moving. So this quote unquote fixed means fixed with respect to the moving reference plane, not fixed in an absolute sense. So to do that, let us consider that there is an inertial reference plane. And there is a non-inertial. So capital X, Y, Z, let us write, this is inertial, and small x, Y, Z this is non-inertial. So that means this reference frame, which is attached to, you know, maybe we can imagine that a lump of fluid or even a lump of a chunk of solid, whatever, this can have arbitrary acceleration. That means linear acceleration or angular or both. So it has a rotation, it has a translation. So let us imagine that there is a point, say P, maybe this cross point, which is given by the position vector r with respect to the small xyz. With respect to the capital xyz, this has a different position. Say capital R. And we also identify the position, the current position of the origin of the small xyz by say in the process we have constructed a vector triangle where we can write capital R is equal to R naught plus 1. So this capital R could be an example of this fixed, so-called fixed vector, or even it could not be, because this point itself may be moving with respect to the small xy. So let us take the first example where instead of, you know, such a general vector which could be fixed or moving with respect to the small xyz, let us take an example where, you know, we consider a vector A which is fixed with respect to small x1. And just for the sake of, you know, understanding, let us say that the small xyz has an angular velocity omega, something like this, in some plane. So let us try to imagine the physical picture of that plane where the small xyz is having angular motion. So if we imagine the vector A, this is the vector A's origin, but let us say this is the plane of rotation and it is moving, it is rotating with angular velocity omega. So because of this rotation, remember that we are talking about a fixed vector A, so fixed means its magnitude will not change, but because of rotation its direction will change. So it will become, this will become the A at time t plus A. This is A at time. So the change is what we call as delta A, which has created the change in orientation of A at t to A plus delta. And this change in orientation is simply this angle delta theta. So if you now try to find out what is dA dt in the absolute sense, that is with respect to capital XY. Or let us forget about capital XYZ. Let us just write an example with just dA dt in an absolute sense, whether you are recording a reference plane capital XYZ or you are putting up a reference frame capital XYZ coincident with small XYZ at this instant, whatever it is, I am not writing capital or small, but without writing anything, I am actually mentioning that I am finding out the true DAD. I mean, in an absolute sense. So what is that? This is simply limit as delta t tends to 0. I am writing with the fundamental definition. A at t plus delta t minus A at t divided by delta. So this is nothing but, as per the vector triangle diagram, delta A by delta. Now, this, what is this delta A? So delta A has a magnitude and has a direction. The magnitude of delta A, how do you find it out? It is quite straightforward. Remember that this delta theta is very small. So that, you know, this straight line or any arc which joins these two, they are almost the same. So in that way, delta A will be equal to the length of this red line times delta theta. Like the arc of a circle is equal to r into theta in that way. So in that way, this will be A into delta theta. That is its magnitude. A is the magnitude of vector. And what is the direction? So imagine that if this is the arc of a circle, and you know, if this is the radial direction, say ER, when delta theta or delta t tends to 0, the arc of a circle will be same as like the chord, and that will, in that limit as delta t tends to 0, will become the tangent. So this is like unit vector in the tangent direction. So this is because of the very careful geometrical consideration, that in the limit as delta t tends to 0, delta theta is small, number one, and number two, that the direction of the chord, arc and tangent all become coincident in that limit. So we can write this as this one, and delta t as limit delta t tends to. So this we consider A, which comes out of this one. This is the direction, and limit as delta t tends to 0, delta theta by delta t is d theta dt, and which is nothing but the angular speed omega. So this is the DAD. Now just calculate the cross product of omega and. So imagine that this rotation is taking place in the xy plane. So this is like xy. This is an example. This example is just for your easy visualization. So if, I mean, this could be applicable to rotation in any plane, but xy plane is just an example so that you can visualize it. So in that way, the angular velocity omega in the xy plane is nothing but the angular velocity vector perpendicular to the plane, which is also the z axis, which we call as ek, the unit vector, cross A into, sorry, into ER. Okay. So that is the direction of A, magnitude into the unit. So what is EK cross ER? Just imagine like this, just for the convenience in understanding. If you temporarily set up your x-axis in this direction and y-axis in this direction, so that x coincides with ER and y coincides with ET, you can do that because x and y are perpendicular, ER and ET are also perpendicular. The difference is that in another instant, ER and ET will change, but x, y are universal. But you know, at this instant, they are coinciding. So when you do that, this is just ER is like I and ET is like J and EK is like K. So this cross product is like K cross I. So this is J and J is ET. So this is omega AE. So in that way, this expression and this expression is identical. So we can write this as omega cross. Okay. So when you have this omega cross A, it gives you an expression for the rate of change of the vector A simply because of the rotation of the reference. But here we consider A as a fixed vector. But A may not be fixed. For example, there could be a particle in the small xyz where the particle is translating relative to the small xyz. So there is no guarantee that it will be fixed. So in that way, if we relax this requirement of fixed, and we can just write, so derivative of any arbitrary vector, it may be fixed, may not be fixed. So it is a simple upgradation of the previous of an arbitrary vector. Now this is not a fixed vector, arbitrary vector. So if we write this now, and just to emphasize that we are finding out the derivative with respect to capital XYZ, because that is an absolute or you can say inertial reference space derivative. So had there be no change of A with respect to time, then this would have been simply omega cross A that we have seen in the previous thing. But on the top of that omega cross A, you could also have a change simply because A is itself changing in small xyz. So I'm just giving you an example. Say you have a particle. The rate of change of position of the particle is, of course, due to the particle which is moving with respect to this disk, plus the rate of change because of the rotation of the disk. So the rate of change because of the rotation of the disk is this omega cross. And the rate of change of the position of the particle with respect to the disk itself is this one. So dA dt with respect to small x. So it's a trivial extension because this term is, is not very trivial to understand. But this addition of this is more intuitive and physically trivial. So this expression is a very, very important expression in vector calculus. And this is known as Chesel's theorem. Remember that the strength of the theorem is this is absolutely general in a sense that A is any vector. Now it could be, for example, position vector, but it could also not be position vector. Now here we are interested for the momentum equation or the conservation law for momentum. That means we want to have an expression for acceleration, because that is the Newton's second law that relates force, that is the cause with the effect, that is the acceleration. Now, we cannot just in one step get acceleration. We should start with the position and differentiate the position vector twice to get acceleration vector. And that is the motivation of our next mathematical steps. So, what we will do is, we will apply this Chesel's theorem to the position. So, our specific example is capital A is equal to R. Okay. So, dr dt with respect to capital X, Y, Z is equal to dr dt with respect to small x, y, z. Plus now you have to keep in mind that capital R is R naught plus small r. So in that way, let us substitute that. So in place of d capital R dt, we will have d capital R 0 dt. And then this one plus omega cross now. I mean, we have to take some specific example to move it forward, because what is, you know, the nature of omega, that we have to really look into. So we have to imagine a specific example. So let us write it one more step. So this we call as R0 dot with respect to small x, y, z. Plus R dot with respect to small x, y, z plus omega cross. So this is one way of looking. The other way of looking into this is as follows. So we can write let me do this. Okay, before that I want to tell you something before telling the other way of writing. So the objective with which we are writing this equation is to change the basis from capital XYZ to small xyz. That means we are observing all the motion in small xyz and trying to relate that with absolute velocity and acceleration. Now, to do that, we can also, you know, write it as a straightforward thing without, you know, this Chesel's theorem. This is what we can do. Instead of writing in this way, this is not wrong. I would prefer this way. Why? The reason is that, you know, let us see that, you know, practically what we mean. So this is what. So if there is a small xyz and so this is the small xyz and this is R naught with respect to the origin of the capital XYZ. What does this give? dr naught dt. That is the linear velocity of this one, the small XYZ with respect to capital XYZ. So this we know. So for example, if we have a moving reference frame, we will know for sure what is its velocity. So in that way, this is known to us. So this we can simply say r0 dot with respect to capital X. But the whole challenge is that how small r is changing with respect to capital XYZ is not so easy. So for that, we apply the Chesel's theorem. In that way, let me just clean this up. What we will do is we will write this equation again at the top. So dr dt with respect to capital XYZ is equal to r0 dot with respect to capital XYZ plus. Now this one we will use the Chesel's theorem. So this we will write dr dt with respect to small xyz plus omega cross r. Right? This is the Chesel's theorem that we have applied. So this term replaced by this. And we are doing it in this way because it's the small r that is the vector that we are talking about. It's the vector which is there in the small x, y. Okay. So this is the velocity. We are not really interested just with the velocity, but a bit beyond that, the acceleration, which will relate with the force. So to do that, we will differentiate this once more. And that is what I will do now. So I will make the second derivative of r with respect to time. So this will become the second derivative, double dot, straightforward. Now, so this is a vector which is a vectors in the small x, y, z. So this is now like say capital A. So we will apply Chesel's theorem on this and Chesel's theorem on this. So this will be d dt of this dr dt with respect to small xyz and, you know, this with respect to small xyz plus omega cross dr dt with respect to small xyz. This is the Chesel's theorem applied for the first term. That is, let me just highlight it. So this is the Chesel's theorem for this. For the second term, it will be very similar. So that is this term. We'll add two more terms. Now this will be like your A. So plus ddt of omega cross r plus omega cross, this A is now omega cross r. So this is the second term. I am putting it in another box just to indicate that these are by Chesel's theorem. So now if we collect all the terms, so d2r dt2 with respect to capital X, Y, Z. This is the capital X, Y, Z plus. Now this term, what is this? This is nothing but second derivative of small r, or r small r double dot with respect to small x, y, z plus omega cross dr dt with respect to small x, y, z is nothing but the velocity with respect to small x, y, z. Then we will write this derivative of this cross product. So the rule of the derivative of the cross product is just like the normal derivative rule, but only difference is that we will consider the order as important. So we write d omega dt cross small r small x, y, z plus omega cross dr dt again small x, y. So because this is small x, y, I have forgotten to write that this is Chesel's theorem. The first term is with respect to small x, y, and the next term will remain as omega cross omega cross. So the final step, you have this as r not double dot plus small r double dot plus let us write this term first, omega cross r plus, then this write this term, this is omega dot, that is the angular velocity cross r. Small r means small r we are measuring with respect to small x, y, z. So plus, now this is very important. So you have, I'm just highlighting two terms. You have one term omega cross v small x, y, z. Another term omega cross v small, because v capital R dt is v small x, y, z. So plus this one plus one, that is 2 omega cross product with so this is a very interesting expression. We have never talked about any physical phenomenon here, but the mathematics is so interesting that it is actually uncovering all the physics. So let us try to look into the physics of every term. The first term is quite clear. It is due to the acceleration of the reference frame itself, that is the reference frame small x, y, z, it is having a linear acceleration. I mean, it may or may not have, but if it is having, this is the second term this one is the rate of change of velocity of the point with respect to small x, y, z itself. So they say a particle is moving in the rotating disk, and this is the rate of change of its position vector with respect to the coordinate system fixed with the rotating disk. The third component is this one. So this omega cross r is nothing but the centripetal acceleration. That means if there is a particle on a reference plane which is rotating, the particle will have an acceleration which is directed toward the center. So that is, you know, in a scalar form, this is just like omega square r, and towards the center. I mean, if you calculate it, it will come out to be minus omega square r in a situation where the center is located at the origin. So this is the centripetal acceleration. So remember, we are writing this as acceleration. So this is centripetal acceleration. This is the acceleration due to the angular acceleration of small x, y, z. So small x, y, z may not always be, it is not just necessary that it is having a constant omega. The omega itself may vary with time, and that will give rise to this acceleration. The last component is the so-called Coriolis component of acceleration. So what is this Coriolis component of acceleration? So imagine that you have a rotating disk in which there is a point. This point is translating with a velocity, and on the top of that, this plane itself is rotating. So there is a translation relative to a rotating reference, and that will cause a sidewise acceleration, which is known as Coriolis acceleration. This Coriolis acceleration is a very important component of acceleration, which is important in various scales, starting from engineering devices to the scale of atmosphere, when in the northern and the southern hemisphere, the ocean currents get deflected, and the ocean currents get deflected because of the earth's rotation, which is the angular velocity omega, and the movement of the ocean current with respect to the earth, which is this v small x, y, z, and that gives rise to lateral motion of the ocean current, which for the northern and the southern hemisphere, because of the senses of this v, r, v. So in that way, we can have various components of acceleration. And now what we have been successful in arriving at is, we have an expression for acceleration with respect to capital X, Y, Z in terms of an acceleration, which could be because of some arbitrary motion of small x, y, z, as well as motion of the particle within small x, y, z. So now let us get back to the Reynolds transport theorem, and let us apply this concept for an arbitrary controlled one. So we will write linear momentum conservation for arbitrary control, arbitrarily moving, let us say, not arbitrary, arbitrarily moving will be the right way of expressing that. Arbitrarily moving control. So let us start with the Reynolds transport theorem. So dN dt, n can be scalar or vector, so let us not write vector to be dN, just any n, dN dt of the system is equal to d, so I'm just writing the general expression. For n, in this case, capital N, let us write. So if you take a small mass dN within the system, so this is dM into dN. So if you write this as ddt of integral of dN into t with respect to the, you know, for the system. So small n is equal to just velocity. Now look into one thing. So there is no commitment that what is this velocity. This could be, you know, with respect to any reference frame. This is the key. This is, you know, you have to understand very, very carefully. So there is no restriction on this capital N. In that way, capital V also, it could be, you know, with respect to any reference. So let us apply this with V small x, y, z. We can do it. I mean, we could do it either small or capital. So let us write it for small. So then the next logical step will be, if it is not a variable mass, then the mass will not change with time. So this will be simply dm into this, you know, rate of change of velocity. So acceleration with respect to small x. Okay. So now we can write this, if this dm is not, or this, you know, mass of the system is not changing with time, and then that is normally the case because that is the definition of a control mass system. So now what we will do is just one more step. So we already have the expression for, a small x, y, z. So what is this? This is not a small x, y, z. This is a capital X, Y, R, capital R double dot. So which one is a small x, y, z here? So acceleration with respect to small x, y, z is nothing but this term. So this is the rate of change of the double derivative with respect to time, or, you know, the rate of change of velocity with respect to small x, y, z. So that is acceleration with respect to small x. So what we will do is that we will express this in terms of all others in this equation. So the left hand side will be integral of dn, acceleration small x, y, z will be acceleration capital X, y, z minus r 0 double dot. I'm not writing capital X, Y, Z, but let us write it if you want. Minus omega cross R. I'm just taking all the terms to the other side so that they become minus. minus omega dot cross r minus 2 omega cross b small x. So what is this small xyz? So far as our Reynolds transport theorem based analysis goes, so let us now write it. So we have not physically related this with fluid dynamics so far, but let us assume that the fluid dynamics is described by a control volume like this, say a control volume. So the small xyz is something which is fixed with the control volume. So wherever the control volume is going, the small xyz is moving with. So all the small xyz will replace it with the relative to the control volume. So that means if you have v small xyz, that means you are considering velocity of the fluid particle relative to the control volume. So that is nothing but this one, this vr. So this is as good as v small xyz if your small xyz is attached to the control volume. So now this will become a dm a capital xyz of this is the system minus integral dm. Integral dm is m, so you can write just integral dm with r0 dot capital xyz plus omega cross r plus omega dot cross r . So what is this? The first term, this is the straight away Newton's second law. So this is the resultant force acting on the system. And we have seen that the Reynolds transport theorem is derived in the limit as delta t tends to 0. So this will be the resultant force on the control volume. Okay. So what is summarily seen is because of the arbitrary movement of the control volume, you have a correction in the force, which you may imagine dm into some the relative acceleration. So this is like an inertial correction, just like what we do when we use D'Alembert's principle for particle mechanics. So we have the actual force with a correction term minus mass into acceleration. And acceleration has the linear component, the angular acceleration, the centripetal angular acceleration, and the Coriolis component. All these four together, you have to keep this in mind. So in that way, our final expression for the momentum balance comes to, so I will write the final expression. So the left hand side will become resultant force on the control volume minus integral of dm into relative acceleration. In a short hand I am writing this, is equal to so what it boils down to is exactly the same form of linear momentum balance that we have used for the previous examples of stationary reference frame, but just with a correction. What is that correction? The correction is this inertial correction. And this inertial correction becomes zero if the control volume is non-accelerating. If it is non-accelerating, then you know all these relative acceleration term will come as zero, and then it doesn't matter whether it is moving or not, except you know for the consideration that you consider the relative velocity in the calculations at all the terms with respect to the control volume. So that is the first absolute mass. The second absolute mass, that is the correction of the force by the pseudo force, you can see. Pseudo force includes this minus sign. So that you have to do if it is an accelerating reference. So the physics of the pseudo force is that if you are sitting on the accelerating reference frame, you feel a force which, number one, is because of the translation of the reference frame, that means you are feeling a force which is due to your inertia is asking you to stay at your place where your reference frame is accelerating, and that is why perhaps pulling you back because of the negative term. Minus of this is the centrifugal force which tries to throw you radially outwards. This is the so-called Euler force which is trying to move you because of the angular acceleration, and minus of this is the so-called centrifugal force, Coriolis force, where the Coriolis force is trying to move you in the sidewise or the lateral direction. So all these pseudo forces are experienced in the reference frame which is an accelerating reference frame, and that correction has to be put in along with the other applied forces which are applied on the control volume. So that's the correction that you have to make, or adjustment that you have to make, to accommodate the consideration of an accelerating control volume. So we will stop here today and take this discussion forward tomorrow with some concrete problems and examples. So as I have mentioned at the beginning of today's class, tomorrow from 10 to 11, you will have the class test, and after 11, we will resume with the class. So that is the tomorrow's plan. So the first 1 hour will be class test, and it will be followed by the regular class. So let us stop the class here. If you have questions, you can always put up questions. If not, we can.
Sir, the syllabus is till last day's class, right? Syllabus.
Yes, yes. Syllabus is syllabus is till last day's thing. Today's thing I will not. Any other question? Okay. So if not, we will close the class and we'll continue tomorrow.